السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله تعالى we'll go through the benefits from Surah Al-Dhariyat. The benefits that we learn from Surah Al-Dhariyat. And these benefits, إن شاء الله تعالى, is just some of the benefits of the Surah. And it's a way for us to learn how to benefit from what we read from the Quran to affect our speech and actions. One of the benefits that we learn from the surah is that it establishes the aqidah or the belief in the hereafter and the reward and the punishment, the recompense, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by this. You know, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, said innama tu'aduna lasadiq, and swearing in the beginning of the surah with some of the creation of Allah that indeed what you have been promised is the truth. Wa inna ad-deena lawaqi', and the deen, which is the recompense, is going to be established and it's going to happen. So this is a great benefit that we see throughout the surah and throughout the entire Quran, to have the hearts attached to the hereafter and what's going to be there, so that a person would act in this life accordingly. Also, one of the benefits is that it establishes the belief in the qadr of Allah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يُؤْفَكُ عَنْهُ أَنْ أُفِكُ. That means the disbelievers or those who are turned away from the Quran, they are turned away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned away those who do not deserve. So everything is by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, it condemns lying, and this is one of the characteristics of the disbelievers, that they lie about the revelations from Allah. They hide, they distort, they deviate, and they are in forgetfulness. So the believers should be different than that, and they should be truthful, because the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth. Also, one of the, of course, when the hellfire is mentioned, when the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned, this is always something that, you know, the benefit of having the fear of Allah and to hope for the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is an act of worship, act of ubudiyyah to Allah that a person should be upon when he is reciting the Quran. The surah talked about the muttaqeen and some of the characteristics of those who fear Allah, those who are dutiful to Allah, and the rewards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for them. And one or some of their characteristics is they, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them of thawab and reward is because of their taqwa, their obedience to Allah and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because they were muhsineen, they were good doers. And as mentioned, to be among the muhsineen is not just to do some actions of ihsan or some actions of goodness. A person has to be consistent in doing the actions of goodness till he becomes from the muhsineen, till it becomes his norm that he is among the good doers in all of one's affairs. And with the repentance fixes the deficiencies and the weaknesses. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised them because they pray the night prayer. And they spend a big portion of the night making salah and tahajjud and ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of their characteristics is that they make istighfar in the last part of the night. So this is a time where al-istighfar before fajr, to say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah al-azim, astaghfirullah al-ladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayh. And they would repeat al-istighfar. They pray the night prayer and they make istighfar. And this is something that a person should be consistent in, even if it's something that is a short period of time, but still this is part of which they, this is their characteristics. And as-sahar is the last sixth part of the night. So they would say Rabbana ighfir lana and so on. And in their wealth, there's a right for the those who ask and those who are deprived. They give the zakah and they give charity. Also, one of these benefits that the ayat and the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the earth are so many that people need to reflect upon, that shows the power of Allah, and also its signs to prove the resurrection and the Day of Judgment. The surah talked about the rizq, and that the rizq is not in the hands of a human being. It's not in the hands of an owner of a company. It's not in the hands of a boss or anything. It's in the hands of Allah. The rizq is fi s-sama' rizqukum. And the ayah starts with fi s-sama', that means in the heavens is your rizq. So if the rizq, the provisions, is from the heavens, therefore a person should not seek it from anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And taking the means, the physical means, is a must, of course, but the heart is only seeking the provisions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is fi s-sama'. So why would the person then have any concerns or any worries? He take the physical means, and the rizq comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that, the verses that talked about Ibrahim alayhi salam, and we talked about that. We had a separate part of the lectures when we talked about the benefits of the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, as Imam al-Sa'di rahimahullah, he mentioned that in his tafsir, the great benefits of what happened to the guests of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that even etiquettes of being a host is something that we learn from these verses. And these are one of the things that no matter what a Muslim is from, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should overtake one's culture. And if the culture is goodness, then it's okay to have it. But without, like, we cannot say, well, because I'm from this part of the world, we're not used to be generous to the guest. That's against the deen of Allah. So the generosity, it should be there. And a person should be generous to the guest. If it's a mandatory thing, especially the first day and night. But anyway, so this is by itself is, such a great benefit. And we talked about the details of that. Shows the virtue of Ibrahim alayhi salam and the obligation of taking care of the guest. And as some of the ulama mentioned, Ibrahim alayhi salam himself, he feared these guests because they acted strange because they were angels. So there's nothing wrong with having normal fear if it's not against the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a normal thing for human beings to have this. Also, it shows that the jobs of the angels, or some of the jobs of the angels, and they come in the images of men, and why they punish the people of Lut, and the actions of the people of Lut is sufficient for people to be punished and to be destroyed, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed the people of Lut and those who follow them in the same actions. And so this is, some great lessons to be learned from this. And there's the mention of the believers and the Muslimin. فَأَخْرَجِنَا مَنْ كَانَ فِيهَا مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we took out of the town of Lut what was in it from the believers, and we did not find any house except, فِيهَا غَيْرَ بَيْتِ مِنْ مُسْلِمِينَ, so just one house of the Muslimin. So every mu'min is a Muslim, of course, but not every Muslim is a believer. Till he works on his Islam and works on his submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, till he reaches the level of al-Iman. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned Musa and the people of Ad and the people of Thamud and the people of Nuh. And what's common in all of these nations is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to them messengers, and the matter was explained to them clearly. They were warned. They were given glad tidings if they believed, but they refused. So as a result of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished them in different ways. But at the end, they were all punished. And the real punishment is the punishment of the hereafter. The punishment in this life is a punishment, but they return also to the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the real punishment of Allah. And their wealth and their strength and everything did not benefit them when the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was revealed for them to be destroyed. And the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over all things. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delay the justice on the face of earth for a great wisdom, and to test the people, and to elevate the believers, and to purify the believers, and to make those who are truthful steadfast, and those who were just joining into the to be with the truthful ones just for some worldly gains, then they leave it. Because again, as mentioned, if, for example, if the Muslimin are being oppressed, Right? It does not, it's not an evidence that if you're an oppressed person that you are on the wrong or on the falsehood. And it doesn't mean if a person is strong and wealthy and so on, that means he's upon the truth. And this is a very obvious thing for anyone that would think. So if it happened and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decree upon the believers to be weak and oppressed, there's a great wisdom behind it. For them to hold fast to the deen and to ruin those who oppress them more and more unless they repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the reality is many people, they compromise their deen, they change the deen, they even leave the deen because the people upon the deen are weak and oppressed and things like this. It's supposed to be the total opposite that we have in these nations, and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did to them, a great sign from Allah, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the believers at the end. Also, you know, so many benefits, of course, to learn from the surah, and it's always the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the power of Allah, that nobody can oppose the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why after mentioning these nations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the heavens and the earth and the mighty creation of Allah. And for everything, Allah created pairs or things like this for people to remember. So then, as if the verses were leading to this one ayah, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ, flee to Allah. Because indeed, the Prophet ﷺ is to you a warner and a one that brings the glad tidings. So al-firar, you know, to flee to Allah, to flee from disbelief, to flee from ignorance, to flee from sins, to the opposite of it. And to warn against the shirk and associating partners with Allah. Also one of these benefits, the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of earth, that people, when they deny the truth, which is as if it's the norm of the people, so they get used to be upon falsehood, so they would defend it. And that's even among the Muslims, if the people do not enjoin and for good and forbid evil, and then people get used to certain evil actions, after some time it becomes their norm. And they would resist changing this. And they would find all kinds of ways and evidences to prove that what they're upon is the truth. So the tughyan, the transgression of oneself, brings all kinds of evil. And to remind and to keep on reminding the believers, and those who would benefit from the reminders are the believers. وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The surah has this great verse that shows the purpose of our creation. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. The purpose of our creation is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anun. Shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich. He does not need the ibadah of his slaves. Those who are in need of it are the human beings. And the rizq. The rizq again is mentioned. Because it's always a subject whenever there comes the ibadah, the rizq comes in place, or the whispers of shaitan that people will be deprived of provisions or rizq or worldly benefit if they obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-razzaq. So your objective in this life is to worship Allah. The rizq will follow, will come. And this is the priorities in one's life that has to be there. Inna Allah huwa ar-razzaqu ذو القوة المتين. He is الرزاق سبحانه وتعالى with the mighty power and strength سبحانه وتعالى. And then the surah ended with the mention of those who transgressed and those who are present at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. They have the same share of those who are before them, as mentioned in the surah. So there's no need to be in haste. What the previous nations went through, the present nation will go through. But there's no need to be haste. فَلَا يَسْتَعْجِلُونَ. And when people return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would receive what the previous nations received. Even if it's for thousands and thousands of years ago. If it's the people of Nuh, they disbelieved, they entered the hellfire. The people, those who are present today, if they oppose the truth and they die in a state of disbelief, they would join with their brethren in disbelief from the time of Adam alayhi salam till the day of judgment. They all go together into the hellfire. And on the opposite side, the believers at this time, if they die, they return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be in the company of the believers from the time of Adam alayhi salam, and to be with the company of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions radiallahu anhum. So there's no need to be in haste. for the hearts to be patient. It's only years or days or whatever time that a person spend on the face of earth. It's not worth it for the person to be in haste, but rather to use it to be obedient to Allah, because everybody will return to what they've used to work on and upon in this life. So the surah ends, فَوَيْلُ لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ يَوْمِهِمُ الَّذِي يُعَدُونَ. Woe to the disbelievers from this day that they have been promised, which is the day of Al-Qiyamah. So the beginning of the surah and the end of the surah about the wa'd of Allah. So if you see the first verses in the surah after the swearing about some of the creation of Allah, إِنَّمَا تُعَدُونَ لَصَادِقٍ. Indeed, what you have been promised is the truth. And at the end, the last verse, woe to the disbelievers from the day that they have been promised. So the end is linked to the beginning of the surah. And that's one of the great things to look into the surahs of the Quran like this. Look at the beginning of the surah, look at the end of the surah, and see how they are linked together. And that gives you an idea what's in between also, with establishing the belief in the promise of Allah, the promise of Allah when it comes to matters of deen, and the obedience of Allah, and the promise of Allah in matters of rizq and provisions, as it's mentioned in the verses. So put your trust in Allah, believe in the promise of Allah, and be patient, because it's the promise of the truth, and you will see it, and it will come, so that the person would then enjoy the fact that he believed and acted according to the promise of Allah. We'll stop here, inshallah. And again, there are more and more benefits. And since we already had went through the first 10 verses or so of Surah At-Tur, so next time, inshallah ta'ala, we'll go to the next set of verses, inshallah. طيب بارك الله فيكم وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.